Abdelrahman had this built during the last year of his life. It was a symbol of consolidation of his economic and political power. Seated in this throne, the Caliph must have felt himself master of all al-ʼAndalus's destiny.
Visitors from all over Europe were received here. A monk from Germany called John of Gorse left a record of his trip.
You have to try and imagine the impression this place would have made on John of Gorse. The walls were studded with tiles made of silver and gold. And on the roof, there was a massive representation of the heavens. Mechanical lions roared in the corridors, and in the rafters, there were mechanical birds that twittered away. Here in the center of the room, there were two bowls filled with mercury that would catch the light and then send it shattering back out to dazzle the visitors. This is what was written about the climax of his visit. When John arrived at the dais where the Caliph was seated alone, almost like a godhead, he saw everything draped with rare and costly coverings. They do not use thrones or chairs as other people do, but recline on divans or couches when conversing or eating, their legs crossed over one another. There is actually one detail that this account misses out. The Caliph did have a throne, a mechanical throne, that raised and then descended as if he was levitating among his subjects.
A refined court culture developed in the palace of Medina al-Zahra. And this was to have an unexpected influence on the rest of Europe.
What would the soundscapes of the palaces have been in the 10th century?
Perhaps the most basic level would be the sounds of all the different fountains and small running currents, artificial rivers running from room to room. On top of that, we could have heard layer upon layer of different types of music and singing. A variety of different professional instrumentalists. We could easily have heard a lute player sitting in a corner or in any of the various different entryways. There would be a slightly more formal presentation of a singing girl.
What were these singers expected to do? Were they concubines as well?
Well, in some sense, we're doing an injustice by just referring to them as singers. These women were entertainers at every level. They had to be able to converse. They had to be able to discuss intelligent subjects. They had to be able to compose poetry, recite poetry. For Arabs, poetry is the single most important art of their culture. If we look at a picture of the entire world, there are only three cultures that we know of that had developed end rhyme by the 7th century: China, India, and the Arabs.
This early Arabic love poetry directly influenced the development of literature in the rest of Europe.
One of the primary characteristics of this poetry is a constant focus on the feelings of the lover. The poet is always complaining of the pangs of love and the distance of the beloved, and we, quite frankly, almost never hear from the beloved.
Love is a welcome malady. Those who are free of it want not to be immune. And those who are stricken want not to be cured.
The pain of separation and unrequited love are concepts that are very familiar to us. And there is a direct connection to that early Arab poetry.
In England, some of our earliest and most enduring stories are romantic tales of knights and damsels, a courtly love tradition brought here by travelling French poets called troubadours.
And those troubadours were inspired by the singing slave girls of al-ʼAndalus.
The courtly love tradition has long been seen as something European. It came to form the basis of the Western concept of romantic love. But this cornerstone of our culture originated in Islamic Spain.
perhaps one of the most exciting moments, the transfer, if you will, of Arab music and poetry from the south to the north, happens in the year 1064 in the city of Barbastro.
Neighboring French knights besiege the city, which falls. Its booty includes hundreds of singing girls who go to the second in command, William VIII of Aquitaine.
He received a large number of Moorish singing girls, which he then took back with him to France. He died at a fairly young age, and his heir, William IX, inherited this household at age 15. And William IX is known to us in literary history as the first troubadour. So it's almost positive that William IX would not only have grown up as a child in a household in which there were Arab singing girls, but at the age of 15, he actually became their master. It's one of the few moments where we can say that there's a transfer of singing girls from this point to that point, and then the point of reception is precisely where the first flourishing of troubadour poetry emerges.
But the glorious court of Medina al-Zahra was not to last forever. Within the palace were sown the very seeds of its destruction. Abdulrahman III had invested much of his money and interest in art and culture, and had paid very little attention to the military. There were no generals at court, and citizens didn't have to serve in the army.
This is important. The mere fact that the army can't recruit from its own citizens means that it has to recruit more and more foreigners, effectively mercenaries. This is part of the reason for the conflict, which led to the ultimate collapse of the Caliphate.
When an ambitious courtier usurped the Caliphate, the court split into factions. Once the 300-year-old dynasty cracked, it didn't take long for the palace to come under attack. Medina al-Zahra was quickly smashed and plundered.
These are the telltale signs that the palace was violently destroyed. They're scorch marks on the marble made when the molten lead that supported the joists in the roof melted as the palace was burnt to the ground.
Of course, the history of Spain would have been very different if Medina al-Zahra had continued to exist and if the Caliphate had not disappeared.
Rahman III's unique dynasty had come to a terrible end.
And in the north of the country, another religious power was eyeing up the rich lands of al-ʼAndalus. Its name was Christendom.
Al-Andalus' golden age was over. By the beginning of the 11th century, Abdulrahman's dynasty in Córdoba had collapsed into chaos and disorder. But what happened next was even more devastating. In 1095, Pope Urban II made a call to arms. He ordered a war to remove Islam from the Holy Lands.
Pope Urban's speech is agitprop at its finest. When an armed attack is made against an enemy, let there be one resounding cry from the soldiers of God. It is the will of God. It is the will of God.
The Crusades had begun. It didn't take long for this zealous warrior mentality to rouse the Christians of northern Spain. And what followed was as treacherous as any of the Crusades in the Holy Lands. The Christians had always held on to the far north of the country, and now they were gaining ground. Al-Andalus had fragmented into a hodgepodge of isolated city-states. Suddenly, Muslim Spain found herself under attack. Her palaces were raided and her cities laid to siege. Between the 11th and the 13th centuries, an army of Christian kings took over the lands of Al-Andalus. Every year, this conflict is reenacted in towns across Spain.
Cristianos.
This, the victor's version of history, glamorizes what was actually a dishonorable and dirty war.
When the Christians come, they break everything. They come in summer when it is almost dry. They put it fire. After that, they cut the trees. The agriculture of Al-Andalus was very sophisticated. The more sophisticated is something, the more fragile it is. So the more easy it is to break it. Irrigation. If you break a canal, there's no more water. So for some years, people are starving.
So it's a scorched earth policy.
Yes.
Soon, a brutal system of protection rackets emerged.
There is an alternative. You pay me, I don't destroy. I don't burn your house. How much do you give me? I don't cut your trees. How much do you give me? This one. It is a way of the mafia in Chicago. For one century, all the 11th century, all the Christian Spain lives at expense of Muslim Spain.
One by one, the fragmented city-states of Al-Andalus were terrorized. Their solution was to fight fire with fire by bringing in troops from Morocco.
This is the capital from the top of a column in Córdoba. It's a buzzing little scene. You've got four musicians, two who are playing pipes and two who are playing the lute. But at some point, the faces of the musicians have been smashed in.
This wasn't perpetrated by Christian raiders, but by the new Muslim power who had come to help Al-Andalus. The troops who came as military support were strict fundamentalists with a fearsome fighting reputation. They were called the Almoravids.
The Almoravids were a tribe of nomads from the Sahara. They had black skin and wore veils that covered everything apart from their eyes. When they went into battle, they rode light-footed, versatile little horses and took with them camels and elephants. But they were fiercest of all when it came to religion. They preached a return to basic Muslim values, and when they came to Al-Andalus, they were shocked by what they found.
They're people from the desert. Yeah, it's people newborn to the religion, so they have a hard feeling of it.
Evangelical Islam?
Yeah, absolutely. Not accustomed to civilization.
Yeah. What did they think had gone wrong with Islam here?
They felt they had to purify things. They said, this is people very accustomed to civilization, to science. They're talking with Christians, with Jews. This is a mix that we don't like it. We want purified people.
With the barbaric Christian raiders on one side and these new fundamentalist Muslims on the other, Al-Andalus was crushed. It descended into corruption. A Christian king would provide military aid to a weak Muslim king in return for a substantial payment of gold coin. The whole of Al-Andalus was subjected to this system of extortion. The trouble is, modern Spain chooses to remember this war rather differently. La Reconquista, the Reconquest, is presented as a valiant crusade in which Spain is returned to its rightful Christian owners. This pantomime version of history is personified in many of Spain's national heroes, the greatest of whom is a knight called Guzman el Bueno. every town in Spain has a street named after Guzman el Bueno. He's one of the country's best-loved historical figures. The story of when Guzman defended the town of Tarifa from Muslim raids is well known in Spain. Guzman's descendants, the Medina Sidonia family, became one of the richest landowners in the country. The Duchess of Medina Sidonia has discovered something remarkable about her illustrious ancestor.
Guzman el Bueno is the first of the Guzman family we know about. He is the founder of the family. He came here and lived in this very house. This is the family archive, although it's more than that. It is a rich source of documents from the medieval period and later.
Was it right that one of your ancestors was involved in the Spanish Armada?
The seventh Duke was involved in that campaign. This document dates from 1288. We know my ancestor was in Al-Andalus a year before because he bought a farm. And this document mentions it. It's a permit for him to export 300 bushels of wheat. Look, you can see the word wheat. And what it says is that he is allowed to take this overseas to where he is from.
Because of the grammar, you can tell that he comes from overseas, not that he was just visiting from overseas.
Yes, probably it refers to a place which was part of Morocco, much larger then than now, a place where neither wheat nor hay could grow.
The Duchess had discovered that her ancestor, the great Christian knight Guzman el Bueno, was actually a Muslim.
This is really a piece of human history. It dates to 1297. The king refers to Guzman as my vassal because he is a foreigner.
Guzman the vassal.
If it wasn't written here, I wouldn't believe it. It was very common for Muslims to ally themselves with Christian factions, especially when Christians were warring with each other.
It must have been quite a surprise to discover that your ancestor was a Muslim.
Yes, a great surprise. This is because there had been a chronicle which dated back to the 16th century, in which the Guzman family had cleaned up its political and ethnic past. Guzman was said to have been born in León. They didn't just do this with the Guzman family, but with all the families that had doubtful ancestors, ancestors of doubtful race. They cleaned it all up. We have a whole load of documents here from the Spanish register, and they turn everything we know about Spanish history upside down. The Spanish are simply inventing history. They have turned history into a fable.
The idea that the Christians and the Muslims were fighting a holy war was created in Spain long after the reconquest actually took place. Even Spain's most famous hero, the swashbuckling El Cid, is caught up in this fantasy. In films and books, El Cid is celebrated as a kind of Christian pin-up, a crusader in the fight against the terrible Moor. But El Cid spent his life, like El Bueno, as a mercenary, fighting for whomsoever would pay him.
The name Cid means the master in Arabic.
So El Cid's an Arabic name?
Yes. In fact, he was the king of Valencia when Valencia was an Islamic city, and he didn't change anything there.
So he had Muslim allies?
That's it. Yeah.
That's not the story you hear, is it?
No, I think the history is much more interesting than the history you hear.
So he was a Christian king, but he didn't force the Muslims that he controlled to convert?
No, no, he was... In fact, we cannot see the Reconquist as a process of conversion. This is a process of trial and error, of people gaining lands and people gaining prestige.
It's just realpolitik, it's all about getting
That's
land.
That's it. We are tainting now everything with an religious ideology, but it's not.
So religion's a kind of convenient excuse rather than the driving force?
Absolutely. Religion is always an excuse.
El Cid and Guzman el Bueno weren't simply Christian soldiers fighting a Muslim enemy. If anything, this was a civil war, with both sides desperately scrabbling for land and wealth.
The idea that the Reconquest was something cut and dried, black and white, something that cleaned up society is absurd. I don't know who came up with that idea.
The Spanish historian Palencia, who said that the Reconquista was nothing but a civil war between Spaniards of two different faiths.
Spain is full of dazzling reminders of how the righteous Christians won the country back from the diabolical Moor. The country's most popular saint is called Santiago Matamoros, St. James, the Moor Slayer. But this romanticized version of history distorts the true nature of this conflict. This was not a holy war. Al-Andalus was destroyed in a dirty grab for land, which lasted for over 300 years. And in this conflict, the more refined society was the one least equipped for war. It was the Christians who had little to lose and most to gain. And what happened when the Christians began to take over exposes a curious respect for Muslim culture. When the Christian King Peter took control of Seville in 1248, this is what he had made. It is a beautiful building. It was built for a Christian, and yet in every way it resembles an Islamic palace. On the walls there are inscriptions from the Quran, and above the door there are dedications to its owner, calling him Caliph rather than king.
The conqueror has been conquered by the culture.
It's a tiny bit unexpected that when this Christian king rebuilt this palace, he made it appear so Arabic. It feels as if we're in the Alhambra here.
Well, this palace has many relations with the Alhambra, especially with the Court of Lions. Both builders, King Muhammad V of Granada and King Peter I of Castile, were friends. You have to consider that in Europe, at this time, there was not an architecture of such a splendor comparable to Al-Andalus, and this made a very big attraction for the Christians, and this is why this architecture was used by the Christians to show to the nobility of the kingdom the power, the authority, this room covered with this marvelous dome. It symbolized a power, because it's the heavens that turns around the king.
But the legacy of Al-Andalus was to affect more than the architecture of Europe. In the midst of this terrible struggle, something incredible was to happen, which would fire the minds of Europeans and expand our intellectual horizons. Thank you. time that it was being splintered by Christian encroachment, Al-Andalus was at the center of one of the most influential shifts in thinking that Europe has ever seen. Between the Middle Ages and the modern era, Europe underwent a massive intellectual and cultural revolution. This shift, known as the Renaissance, transformed the human experience. It prompted the exploration of science and the arts and changed the way that men and women saw themselves in relation to God. The Renaissance and the scientific revolution that followed were critical stages in the development of Europe. The origins of the Renaissance are generally believed to lie in Italy, where a renewed interest in the classics had a huge impact on art and culture. But the foundations of the Renaissance were laid much earlier, and not in Italy, but in a town called Toledo in Islamic Spain. Toledo was one of Al-Andalus's vulnerable city-states, and in 1085, the Christians seized control of it. Unusually, the handover went very smoothly, and as a result, the Muslims already living in Toledo were allowed to remain as citizens and their mosques were left untouched. The city that emerged accommodated both Muslim and Christian.
Spain at this time is a paradox. On one hand, tensions between Muslims and Christians are becoming unbearable, and yet on the other, there is a hugely beneficial intellectual evolution that is only possible because Muslims and Christians are living side by side.
When Toledo fell to the Christians, its doors were opened to travelers and intellectuals from all over Europe. These people mixed with the Muslims in the city, learning their language and reading their books. Many of the adventurers came from England.
In the late 1100s, an Englishman known as Daniel of Morley travelled to Europe to study. But as his autobiography reveals, he was disgusted with what he found there. I stopped a while in Paris, and there I saw asses rather than men, pretending to be very important. They had desks in front of them, heaving under the weight of two or three immovable tomes, but because they did not know anything, they were no better than marble statues. I did not want to get infected by a similar petrifaction. But when I heard that the doctrine of the Arabs was in fashion in Toledo, I hurried there as quickly as I could so that I could hear the wisest philosophers in the world.
Just as the fall of Alexandria had made a massive body of Greek knowledge available to the Arabs 400 years previously, now the Christian conquest of Toledo passed this storehouse of knowledge on to Europeans, who flocked here in their hundreds.
At the backs of shops and in courtyards, groups of men started to gather together, Christians, Muslims and Jews, to work on texts that had been stored in the archives of mosques and churches. These were extraordinary manuscripts, translations of Aristotle and Plato and Euclid, as well as original works by Arabic mathematicians, astronomers and alchemists. This was a resource like no other in the rest of Europe. It was intellectual dynamite.
People came from all over Europe. All these works that were lost in Europe could be found in Toledo. There was lots of wisdom here.
How did the translators work together here in Toledo?
In the first period, there was usually two people working together. And then another person who was learned in Latin would write it down in Latin. And that was, I think, the target of working together, and it was very clear. I think it really made it more accurate because it was a teamwork.
How long were these manuscripts being kept in Toledo?
Well, most of the translations were carried out in the 12th and 13th century. That means for almost 900 years, most of them. And here we have the preface in red. That's where we learn about the process of translation. In this case, we read that this book was translated by Ger of Cremona
It is a medical treatise by Ibn Sina, by Avicenna, and it was translated ab Arabico from Arabic in Latinum, into Latin, in Toledo.
Yeah, it's a very rich document, isn't it? You get a sense of how valued these things were.
And there is all these little glosses on the right-hand side. People have been adding comments or explaining words that were not clear. Un momento, por favor. Vamos a...
Wow, that's a splendid beast of a thing.
Yeah.
Is this a, looks like it's a work of Aristotle, is it?
Yeah, this is the Rhetorica by Aristotle. Rhetorica Aristotelis.
And here we are, look, here's a man who's working on it. Hermanus Alemannus.
Yeah, Hermann the German.
Hermann the German.
Yeah, even Germans came all the way to Toledo to find all these texts. And in this case, it is a commentary by Averroes on the text of Aristotle.
Oh.
And both are translated together.
So it's got added value because you've got new Arabic thought coming into the classical text.
Yeah, they are adding, they are supplementing, they are completing what was transmitted from the ancient world.
Knowledge really is power at this time in history.
It is. So. Having a book was something very, very valuable.
Do you find during this process that words slip from one language to another?
Absolutely. Chemia. That word came into Western languages as chemistry. But we have another word, alchemy, that comes originally from Greek through Arabic. They added the article in Arabic, al, and that gave alchemy.
English is full of words which came into the language from Arabic in this way. Many of them describe mathematical concepts which were completely new to Europe. Algorithms are named after an Arabic mathematician, and the concept of zero comes from the Arabic sifr, which means empty. It's where we get our word cipher from. But of course, the most obvious and lasting impact is the use of Arabic numerals, and in this Spanish Latin text, which dates from around about 986 AD, we have the first example of Arabic numerals written in Europe. Here they are. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Imagine trying to do something like multiplication with Roman numerals. Once the numbers get above a certain amount, they are ridiculously unwieldy. This new, agile numerical system made everyday things like bookkeeping and accounting more accessible. Mathematics developed, and the construction of complex architectural projects became much easier. Recently, archaeologists renovating the roof timbers of Salisbury Cathedral in England made a discovery which clarifies this story. On some of the beams that support the roof, there were a series of numbers that were carved in around 1200 AD when the cathedral was built. Now, that's a 3, and obviously it's familiar to us today, but in its time, it was a curious and progressive symbol. At this time, everyone in England was still using the clunky old Roman numerals, but here in the rafters of one cathedral, a new trend appears to have caught on. These numbers, the numbers that we use today, the fact that they're here is proof that the ordinary craftsmen who carved them benefited from an explosion of knowledge that started in Arabia and spread through Europe via Islamic Spain. And the travellers from Toledo brought more than just practical knowledge back to England. After a number of years, Daniel of Morley returned from Toledo. His cases crammed with documents and volumes. And when he arrived in England, he made an appointment to hand this precious booty over to his patron, who was a bishop. This benefactor was one of a team of scholars who wanted to establish their town as a centre of learning. And the name of the town was Oxford. The universities that were founded in Paris, Bologna and Oxford at this time based their new curriculum on the radical ideas which were pouring out of Toledo. One of Daniel of Morley's compatriots, a man called Adelard of Bath, published this volume just after he got back from Toledo. It's a collection of 76 very basic questions, like, why is the sea salty? Why are there tides? How does the globe hang in the air? And do animals have souls? The questions are seemingly simple, but they embody a new spirit of rational inquiry, where a blind faith in God is challenged. And Adelard of Bath admits his debt to the Muslims in pursuing this line of inquiry. He writes, "From the Arabs, I have learnt one thing, to lead by reason. I will detract nothing from God, but very carefully listen to the limits of human knowledge. Only where this utterly breaks down should we refer things to God."
The Muslims develop a massive program of translations in which they translated from Greek into Arabic everything that had reached them. And this was something that was promoted by the whole society. And the result of this is that they translated practically all Greek knowledge. There's a first period in which they translate and they learn, they assimilate. Later, they had learned enough and they began to produce original works by themselves and to criticize Greek science. And of course, one cannot say that the Arabs were mere transmitters of Greek science. They were the people that continued the work of Greek scientists until they led all this research into a final crisis. And this final crisis was the crisis that brought the Renaissance and the Scientific Revolution. If they had not done this, Renaissance and Scientific Revolution would have been impossible.
It would take time for these groundbreaking ideas to become assimilated into Christian Europe. But once they were, Western intellect was transformed. The works of Aristotle were taught in the new universities. The medical treatises of Avicenna were used in hospitals. And Arabic translations of Greek geometry and those new Arabic numerals were passed on to craftsmen and architects. This was a critical stage in the growth of Western thought. We should no longer see the Renaissance as a rebirth, but the continuation of an intellectual movement which had been nourished centuries earlier by Muslims. The Italian Renaissance is famous for reviving classical learning, but in fact what's happening here 400 years earlier seems to be just as vital. Do you think that Muslim scholars aren't given due credit for what they're doing in Islamic Spain at this time?
It is not something that you would learn about in school, probably, or even at university. It was probably a conscious process of neglect, and now we are still suffering from that.
Extremely selective history writing.
That's right. It is due to the conflict that existed between the two worlds.
These remarkable ideas were leaching out of Al-Andalus at precisely the same time that the Christians were flooding in. The frontier, which had started far north of Madrid, was gradually pushing southwards. Then, in 1236, Cordoba fell, followed by Valencia and Seville, until by 1250, only the Kingdom of Granada remained Muslim. From now on, Spain would concentrate on cleaning the Muslim presence from its country.
The Islamic influence on Europe has been quietly laid down. But when it came to the physical expulsion of the Muslims from Spain, that would be an act that was anything but subtle. It was shocking and absolute. The history of Al-Andalus was about to take a new and sinister turn. In the city of Granada, the Muslims were to fall victim to one of the most shocking acts of ethnic cleansing that Europe has ever seen. Long after the rest of Al-Andalus had fallen to the Christians, Granada remained defiantly Islamic. Protected by mountains and those giant watchtowers and forts, the 70,000 Muslims who lived here managed to hold off attack for another 200 years. But time was running out. While Granada occupied a small territory in the south of Spain, the rest of the country was now divided between Castile in the west and Aragon in the east, two very powerful kingdoms. The king of Castile was about to be forced to pass his kingdom to his niece, Isabella. Isabella was headstrong and passionate, but she also had an acute political mind. In 1469, at the age of 18, she married her second cousin, Ferdinand, the dashing heir to the throne of Aragon. Now, the two most powerful Catholic dynasties in Spain were united, and the reconquest was edging ever closer to completion. Granada was blocking Isabella's vision of a unified Spain, and so it had to be reclaimed. The city was laid to siege for a year before it finally surrendered. On the 1st of January 1492, Ferdinand and Isabella dressed in elaborate Moorish outfits, which they had especially made. With great pomp and circumstance, they entered the palace of Alhambra and took the keys to the city. As the Muslim ruler Boabdil left in tears, it was said that his mother spat out at him, "Do not weep like a woman for that which you cannot defend like a man." Isabella's victory in Granada put an end to an incredible society. In the 700 years that they'd been in Europe, the Muslims of Al-Andalus had built a culture which was the very pinnacle of civilized life, influencing Europe in ways that we're only just beginning to understand. And Isabella would endeavor to ensure that Islam in the West would never enjoy such a relationship again. A few years after Ferdinand and Isabella came to power, they set up an organization that affected the most extreme form of religious control that Europe has ever known. The Inquisition. The purpose of the Inquisition was to track down and eliminate anyone who wasn't an Orthodox member of the Catholic Church. Those found guilty of heresy were subjected to a sinister public ceremony called an auto de fe. In this eerie ritual, vestiges of which are still performed today, the guilty were forced to repent their sins while their accusers watched on, hidden under hooded caps. The sinners were then detained. Some were burnt at the stake. Most had their homes and livelihoods taken from them. In 1526, the Spanish Inquisition came to Granada to deal with the Muslim problem. Muslims were labeled heretics and given a stark choice: convert to Catholicism, leave the country, or be punished. The Muslims of Granada were segregated from the rest of the population. Their ghetto survives as the old quarter of the city today.
It's a fantastic house. Thank you.
Many of the houses that the Muslims were forced out of are still standing. Antonio Orihuela lives in one.
It's almost inverted because you don't have any windows. looking out onto the street, but the focus is in the middle, here on the courtyard.
Yes, the courtyard is the center of the family life. So all the doors and windows are open to the courtyard and closed to the street. Privacy was one of the most important characteristics of these houses. Outside the house, they were Christian. They went to the church with the priest, they celebrate the wedding in the Christian way, but then later they came home to celebrate again the wedding in the Muslim style.
And what happened though when the Inquisition came knocking on the door?
Well, as you see, these houses had the bent entry. So from outside, even if the door is open, it's not possible to see what happens in the courtyard.
The inquisitors went from door to door, seeking out those they still suspected of being Muslim. A number of civic leaders had already been expelled, and so often it was only women and children left. They herded them up and held them in churches by night so they could be tried the following morning. Some of the women cried out that they were like lambs being taken to the slaughter and wished that instead they'd been allowed to die in their own home. The Inquisition was so brutally efficient that within 20 years, all Muslims in Spain had been forcibly converted to Catholicism. But this wasn't enough. Many still continued to practice their faith in private. And so, in 1609, the Spanish crown ordered the removal of all Muslims from Spain.
Perhaps the most shocking thing in the expulsion is they were not actually expelling Arabs, nor were they expelling Berbers. The huge majority of the people that were being expelled by blood, by DNA, if you will, were as Iberian as their Christian cousins in the north who were kicking them out of the peninsula. It's an enormously different vision of what the expulsions were and what they meant when we realize that the people who were being thrust out were as native to the peninsula as the Christian kings.
Why do you think the Catholic authorities felt they had to expel the Moors in 1609?
The Spanish Empire, for it was indeed by then the Empire, simply felt pressed by in so many different directions. They were very much afraid of the Turks, who were in fact raiding from North Africa and raiding along the southern coast of Spain. They were fighting wars still in the Americas. It was one internal problem that they simply could not deal with any longer.
In 10 years, over 250,000 Muslims were expelled from Spain. Forbidden to take any possessions with them, most sought refuge in North Africa. When Isabella and Ferdinand died, this is where they were buried. It's a little corner of the Alhambra, and it's decorated with inscriptions from the Quran. They read, "There is no true God but Allah." In many ways, it's a curious choice for a Christian entombment, but it does speak of that complicated relationship that was enjoyed by the Catholics and the Muslims. On one level, it says that Isabella and Ferdinand were still half in love with all things Islamic, but on the other, it's a bold and uncompromising statement of control. In Córdoba, the new Catholic rulers did something unbelievable. In a daring act of what can only be described as inspired vandalism, architects gouged out the center of the mosque. In its place, built one of the most spectacular cathedrals in Spain. The result is a shocking and blasphemous conflation of two of the world's most powerful religions. It is unnervingly beautiful, but possesses an underlying schizophrenia, as if a terrible and silent battle is being carried out in the very architecture of the building. Spain's
Spain's troubled relationship with its Muslim past continued into the 20th century. The dictator Franco invented his own version of his country's heritage.
For Franco, this period was somehow interrupting what was for him a continuum history. He wanted somehow to, if not delete it, he wanted to forget about it. So what he did was to explain the whole Muslim or the whole al-ʼAndalus as a kind of continuum from the Visigothic period to the Catholic kings, by saying that the Muslims in al-ʼAndalus were not such big good Muslims, but much more Christianized. So this is the political use of history. He wanted to explain the identity of being a Spaniard.
And for Franco, that identity was a continuation from the Visigothic period right through to the Catholic period.
Yeah, exactly.
Serafin Fanjul is an academic whose books on the history of al-ʼAndalus are bestsellers in Spain.
Do you think that Spanish people today are proud at all of the Arabic episode in their history, or are they ashamed of it?
No, not at all. Strictly speaking, it's not our past. It's the past of other people. As a modern-day Spaniard, I would feel very little connection with the Arab past. Spanish people don't live like them. We don't dress like them. We don't feel like them. I don't know how you can say we are the same, because we are not the same. We have nothing in common. Nothing in common. And if I weren't a professor of Arabic studies, I would have absolutely no feeling for Muslim culture.
For a very long time, people have protested and urged that history be truthfully told, that they not be fed this nonsense. But this is the inheritance of the Inquisition. The Inquisition's character is alive and well. I can tell you one thing. Spanish people have a tendency to prevent others from speaking their minds, a tendency to try and control the way others behave and think. You can be sure that when you try and speak the truth, you pay for it.
And so al-ʼAndalus fell. East became East, and West became West. Two distinct cultures, politically and religiously divided. And yet, what the history of the Moors shows is that these two cultures are also linked in ways that we might never have imagined. The West has been inspired by Islam, but more than that, it was in the very act of fighting the Muslims that Europe consolidated its identity.
When we started, Christopher Columbus was setting sail for the New World, and as he pointed his boats westwards, Spain aligned herself with him, turning away from the East. The Muslims had been fought, and now they were to be forgotten. As time went by, memories of the Islamic past were molded until they became a more comforting storybook version of history. But this is a case where truth really is stranger than fiction. The story of al-ʼAndalus isn't a simple tale of good versus bad, East versus West. It's intriguing and complicated, it's brilliant and brutal, it's very human and it's very messy. And it's for precisely that reason that it needs to be remembered, not written out of the history books.
Well, if you want to know more about the many cultures that have shaped and changed Britain, visit Origination Insight at channel4.com/culture. Coming up next on 4, Father Ted is tempted by a saucy novelist.